The fifth and final day of competition for the individuals at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games, and it's time to decide whose skills will pay the bills. Thanks for joining us, everybody. I'm Sean Woodland, alongside 2009 CrossFit Games champion Tanya Wagner, and Nikki Brazier is on the soccer field here at the StepUp Center in Carson, California. Overall standings for the women through 10 events, there was a bit of an adjustment last night. It was determined that Sandra Bocelli actually won event number 10. That means that Tia Claire Toomey lost 6 points. She's still your overall leader, but now by just 8 over Catherine David's daughter and by 12 over Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Samantha Briggs and Brooke Wells, trying to work their way onto the podium. The first of 3 back-to-back-to-back events is the handstand walk.
I love that we are seeing these skills come out, and they have to perform them in quick sprints. The first one will be a 280-foot handstand walk. These athletes will get credit for even partially getting down the field, however far they can perform the handstand walk.
There are 20 athletes in this first of 2 heats. A lot of women who are trying to get themselves into the top 20 and possibly into the top 10. And in lane number 17, 9-time games participant, Becca Voigt.
Rebecca Voigt, you know, you never know if she, or showing Sheila Barton, I'm sorry, here. She's another one of those athletes, that a strong athlete, that she's been here 2 times. But Becca Voigt, 9-time games athlete, there she is. You never know if you're going to qualify. You never know if this could be her last year. It very well could be the last time we see Becca Voigt have a final day at the CrossFit Games.
And someone who's looking to do well in this event is Camila Blanc-Bazinet.
Typically, we don't see her in the first heat of many events, haven't in the past, but she will do well, especially given her competitors in this heat.
And then Jen Smith, who has gutted through an injured foot since day one, she's still in the competition.
The picture of heart.
One rep for every solid line they pass here. That's a 20-foot section, so 14 total reps for the athletes. You have to go all the way through one section before you kick down. If you kick down in the middle of those solid lines, you have to return to the prior solid line and start again. So Becca Voigt working her way down the field. Jen Smith is your leader. Carly Fuhrer is there too.
For Jen Smith, this will be her best event because the next two will be done on her feet. And with that plantar fascia issue she's dealing with, she knows that this is the best thing for her. There's nothing she has to worry about with her foot.
Camila Blanc-Bazinet, Jen Smith, Emily Bridgers, Carly Fuhrer, and Jamie Haggia fighting for the lead. Stacy Tovar is out towards the front as well, and now Camila Blanc-Bazinet has kicked off.
And this is just such a long distance for these athletes, and there's such a great risk reward when there is that head-to-head battle and you're side by side. You want to push, but if you don't make it, 20 feet to go back is very far. That's a lot of ground to make up and a lot of time it's going to take out of you.
You can kick down before one of those broken lines. Now Camila Blanc-Bazinet, that's a 20-foot section. She's got to get past that line if she's going to kick down. She doesn't want to go back. So Camila Blanc-Bazinet is first past that line. Carlene Matthews will not beat Emily Bridgers across. In lane 3, that was Alexis Johnson, who comes in second. Camila Blanc-Bazinet is third.
And Emily Bridgers, one of those names we're typically used to seeing who does very well on the handstand, any handstand event.
That is Becca Voigt. There are 50 points on the line here. This is not a 100-point event. The winner gets 50 points. Becca Voigt shaking out her arms. 3-minute time cap. That's Carlene Matthews trying to catch up with Becca Voigt, but Becca Voigt is going to get herself across the finish line. And the 9-time games vet will finish in fourth place with a time of 236.82 seconds. Carlene Matthews is off of her hands, but she has a pretty sizable lead over the rest of the field. She's on the right of your screen. Stacy Tovar is creeping up on her. Matthews is done. And that's the 3-minute time cap. So Matthews finished the handstand walk, but does not get across the finish line. So that means that she will hit the time cap. And we have a quick reset before the next heat comes out. And this is the finish, as Emily Bridgers was able to just get across the finish line ahead of the two women chasing her, Camila Blanc-Bazinet and Alexis Johnson. 30 seconds. So after the first heat, Emily Bridgers has the time to beat, 151.51 seconds. It's Alexis Johnson in second place, followed by Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet. And now the second heat of 20 women is on the field, and your overall leaders will be right in the middle of the field.
And there is a race for points, as it is so tight. The top three are separated by 12 points.
Catherine David's daughter, who comes in just 8 points behind Tia Toomey. It's Annie Thor's daughter in the light blue shorts, black top. She is the first one out. She and Catherine David's daughter leading the field. David's daughter's on the right of your screen. Again, they have to complete each 20-foot section unbroken, or they have to go back to the beginning of that section. Catherine David's daughter has not come down yet. Every 20-foot section counts as one rep for 14 total reps to complete the event. Carrie Pierce is in the dark blue. She is just passing Annie Thor's daughter.
Many of these athletes perform the best. If you ever see handstand walks at the regional competition, they perform the best in their region, and now they're side by side getting to race against each other.
Annie Thor's daughter is on the left. Carrie Pierce is on the right. Carrie Pierce, a former gymnast from the University of Michigan. But meanwhile, Catherine David's daughter is in the lead. And she's trying to pick up points on Tia Toomey here and possibly overtake her for the top spot. Now Carrie Pierce has moved into second place. Brooke Wells and Annie Thor's daughter are fighting for third, and Thor's daughter falls. Now that means that she's got to go back to that line. That's going to cost her big. Brooke Wells is back up on her hands as Catherine David's daughter is getting close to the finish line. She's got to get over the white line, but here comes Carrie Pierce, and this is going to be a foot race to the finish. And David's daughter gets there just ahead of Carrie Pierce, and she is going to pick up 50 points. And now the question, how much is she going to pick up on Tia Toomey?
280 feet these ladies just went unbroken. That was unreal, given with the last day of competition. Oh my word, that was awesome.
Kristen Holta, Tasia Persevich, Annie Thor's daughter still is on the field. Thor's daughter is back up, she's in the middle. I think that's Kristen Holta at the top. And Tia Toomey is towards the back of the pack, and she's gonna watch her overall lead disappear after this event. Right next to her is Sarah Sigmund's daughter. Sigmund's daughter has got to finish ahead of Tia Toomey if she wants to pick up points.
This is really about damage control for Tia Toomey here in this event. Sarah Sigmund's daughter typically does better than this. I'm a little surprised to see her holding back.
But Tia Toomey's event is going to be the suicide sprint that is up next. She is great on her feet, not so good on her hands, and both of these women are in danger of getting time capped. Now Tia Toomey will kick down again. She has 20 seconds to get herself across the finish line, as does Sarah Sigmund's daughter. Tennille Reed and Anna Tunnicliffe have finished. Tia Toomey is in, got both of her hands in the white, so she'll get in inside that 3 minute time cap. And Sarah Sigmund's daughter is in as well.
They just squeaked in, but man, Catherine David's daughter ran away with that. Carrie Pierce did have to come down one time, but still made it a race with Catherine, and that was huge for the overall leaderboard for Catherine to get those points over Tia Toomey.
Well, Catherine David's daughter unofficially picks up 27 points on Tia Toomey. She's going to move into the overall lead. David's daughter wins. Carrie Pierce finishes second, followed by Brooke Wells and then Emily Bridgers, who set the time to beat in the first heat. So the handstand walk is now done. This was a huge race as far as damage control is concerned for your overall leader and the woman in third.
And if Sarah Sigmund's daughter is looking to be back on the podium, she is looking to make an even better statement than last year, not be in third. That's not going to do it for her and be helpful. But Catherine David's daughter was so smooth all the way through 280 feet on her hands without coming down. Look at that focus and determination. Just feet inches away from that final line and is able to hold it tight.
Event number 12, the Suicide Sprint. And if you've played basketball or football or any sport that has lines on the field, you're familiar with this. It's a down and back, down and back, down and back, then down again sprint.
The athletes are going to be going 100 feet down one direction, 180 back, and then finish up the full length of the field. So this is a relatively long suicide sprint. It's not the short sprints that you're used to, but anytime they're sprinting, Christy Adkins does very well in competition.
Christina Seeley, another athlete you're going to want to keep an eye on in this heat, making her CrossFit Games debut as she was fifth place in the West.
And I'm sorry, that first picture was Candace Wagner. This is Christine Seeley. She has a track background, and so she will do well in this event.
Another 50 points are on the line here. Every turn counts as one rep. They have to go down and back. Stacey Tovar and Christy Adkins side by side making the turn again.
This event is not just about pure speed. Because of the cuts, they have to be agile. They have to be able to quickly maneuver around those pylons and not waste precious time.
Christy Adkins is ahead of Stacey Tovar. This is the final turn. And then it's across the finish line. So Leah Helmick is legging it out. It's going to be a close one at the finish line. And it's Leah Helmick who's going to get the best of Meg Reardon by 0.1 seconds. Madeline Sturt across the finish line as everybody is now in. But Leah Helmick has the time to beat. That's the thing we know for sure. Jen Smith on that bum foot is still going. This test is not going to beat her, and she is determined to make it all the way through.
With a smile on her face, she's going to keep going, try to make it within that 2-minute time cap.
Listen to the crowd as Jen Smith works her way to the finish line. Moral victory for Jen Smith. Alethea Boone was supposed to be in this heat, but unfortunately last night she suffered a tear of her Achilles and had to withdraw from the competition. That happened in event number 10. 100%. But Jen Smith gives it 100% here and gets across the finish line. Next heat is up. Leah Helmick has the time to beat. 50 points on the line in this event. Overall leaders again are going to be in the middle of the field and unofficially right now. That's Catherine David's daughter. Here's the finish.
Leah Helmick just running away with it on that final sprint that they had to do. She's coming off of her best finish, which was a fourth place in 100% last night. Taking that into the sprint this morning for the rookie. That sets her up to have a good final day here at her first CrossFit Games.
And Catherine David's daughter unofficially has the overall lead thanks to her win in the handstand walk. But this is now the event where Tia Toomey could regain it.
Catherine David's daughter has a lot of competition here. She's worked a lot on her running over this past year, but we'll see if she can hold her own next to Tia Toomey.
And Tia Toomey started CrossFit to help her with her 400-meter hurdle time. First pylon turn is down. Also want to keep an eye on Brooke Wells in this event. She's another athlete who has a track background. Tia Toomey, though, is in the lead, and she will be the first woman to the second pylon. She is ahead of Catherine David's daughter.
This is so important. She has to make up that ground that she lost on that handstand walk.
Toomey makes the final turn, and she'll head home. She's trying to lock up 50 points. She is in the lead. But Turi Helgadottir at the bottom of the screen is putting on pressure. It's going to be Helgadottir and Toomey, and Toomey is going to take it. So Tia Toomey answers back here in the sprint, and she will win the event. Turi Helgadottir will finish in second. Now David's daughter finishes in 10th in the event. So Toomey is going to pick up 20 points on Katherine David's daughter. And now I'm not sure who has the overall lead.
Lynn, Katherine's face, she is not happy with that. There is one more event, though, for redemption. Could even the playing field, and it's going to be the plow coming up.
Now, meanwhile, Sarah Sigmund's daughter finished 21st. That's good for 19 points, but Tia Toomey is looking forward to getting on the field for this event.
You know, she was out in the start, led the pack the whole way. It was the final race, that final sprint down the field. She had the pressure on, but she kept the lead. She put on a little show there and shows us what her background really was about.
Toomey gets the win, and Aaliyah Helbig will lock up second place. That'll be good for 47 points, and Meg Reardon finishes in third. Turi Helgadottir put pressure on Tia Toomey there at the end, but that's just how close it was at the top of the leaderboard, less than a second separating first from fifth.
There's
final
three,
event is the plow now.
We have three very different sprints. Sprint on your hands, sprint on your feet, and now you're going to pull this plow as fast as you can. The plow weighs 190 pounds. The athletes did not have any practice, any time to use this, touch it, get a feel for what it feels like. They're going to have to pull it 560 feet. Athletes with the strong legs, athletes that can have a nice solid core, Jamie Hygiea, they're gonna have the advantage on this one. They're going to be the athletes to watch for. It's a little different when you are sprinting with an object versus just sprinting yourself. Your best sprinters won't necessarily make your best plow pullers. Aaliyah Helmick, though, she is a strong athlete, likes the weights. She just did well in the running event. For her strength, abilities, and her running background together will combine and make this be a good event for her. And Emily Abbott, if there is an athlete that may really have done this before and had to run with a plow on her parents' farm, she just might be the only athlete that's done that. And so for Emily Abbott, I really expect this to be an event that she will and should do well at.
The last time that the athletes had sort of an implement that they had to move around, it was the sprint sled. That was a new thing that they had a couple years ago. And it was sprint sled one and sprint sled two were the events, and Emily Abbott won one of those events. But that's the plow, and this is the, like I said, the first time that they've gotten their hands on this thing. They're going to have to figure this thing out really quickly. It's down and back. The winner gets 50 points.
All of these athletes, they've dragged sleds before, and it's similar to that, and yet it's very different. A sled you have usually tied around your shoulders, around your waist, and you can drive with your arms to get your momentum. This is very different. You're going to hold onto it with your hands. That grip is going to be a factor, and you have to generate all your power and momentum from your legs and your core.
And Aaliyah Helmick actually has some chalk with her to help her with the grip. She's chalked up the handles and her hands. Camila Blanc-Bazinet getting focused. Athletes having to start with their hands on their heads so they don't get an unfair advantage to grab that thing. And Emily Abbott in the middle of your screen is one of the women who is out front early. Abbott is in the green shorts, red hair, and she is your leader as she gets to the first curl. They got to go down, turn that thing around however they can, and then drag it back. But it's Becca Voigt who's up there as well. Becca is in the lead.
Great choppy steps, short, real strong, but fast steps that she's using, leaning forward, putting her body into it.
Becca Voigt is across. She thinks she just won, but she's got to get back on that thing and drag it back. She let go and started to celebrate, and that's going to cost her because Emily Abbott has made the turn and has now overtaken the lead from Rebecca Voigt. You don't see that type of mistake from Becca Voigt very often.
That was a costly mistake. She went out so hard thinking it was just one distance down. And look how far Emily Abbott is ahead of her now.
28 total reps on this. Each 20-foot section is one rep.
And very methodical. Look at this pace. She just keeps on plugging away one step at a time, head down, keeping her core locked in.
Emily Abbott is all by herself in the lead. Carly Fuhrer is close and starting to pick up some ground. She's at the bottom of your screen. But Emily Abbott with about a 40-foot lead on Fuhrer. Fuhrer is starting to chew into that, but Emily Abbott is just going to keep that methodical pace and get herself across the finish line in first in this heat. Emily Abbott loves her some good old-fashioned grunt work. 1 minute, 55.44 seconds. Carly Fuhrer, she is in second place. Christy Adkins coming across. Jamie Hagia and Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet also finishing. Hagia is going to get in ahead of LeBlanc-Bazinet. And here comes Becca Voigt, who had the lead on the first leg, but celebrated way too early and then found out that she still had a ton of work left. And Becca Voigt is across the finish line. 229.49 seconds for her. 50 points on the line in this event as well.
Such a shame. She was out to such a great lead. You wonder if she would have slowed down a little bit, where she would have really placed.
Carlene Matthews and Meg Reardon have finished. Maddie Sturt, the youngest competitor in the field. Still some athletes out there on the field as we get close and now are hitting that 3 minute time cap. And that's going to do it for this group of ladies here in the soccer stadium. And Emily Abbott right now has the time to beat. 155.44 seconds. She's the only woman to go sub two. Carly Fuhrer put up a fight there at the end. But Emily Abbott was trailing Becca Voigt, who thought she was done with the event when she crossed this line.
She raced forward, celebrated, took a breather. When she turned around, she would realize, oh no, I'm not done. With a smile on her face, though, she turned around, but it was too late. Emily Abbott had already won this thing. She ran away with it. A little adjusting on the grip, but her feet never stopped. Her legs didn't ever change. Nice methodical steps, strong lean forward. She knew what she was doing on this one.
Just another day on the farm for Alberta's Emily Abbott. One more heat to go in event 13, the plow worth 50 points. Unofficially coming in to this heat, Tia Toomey is your overall leader by 1 point on Catherine Davis' daughter. Sarah Sigmund's daughter is still in third, but she is 44 points back of the lead. And Sam Briggs sits in fourth place and has announced that this is the last time she's going to compete as an individual at the CrossFit Games.
She's told us that this is her final day, and there's a lot of adrenaline, a lot of nerves, and especially after taking a 36th on the handstand walk, a 15th on the sprint, Sam Briggs has to make up some points right now if she wants to get back on that leaderboard.
Tia Toomey, the overall leader coming into this event. She briefly surrendered it after the handstand walk, regained it in the sprint. And now we'll see who goes in to the rest of the day with the overall lead for the women. Second and final heat. This is event 13, worth 50 points. It's the plow, down and back. Every 20-foot section, so every line on the field counts as one rep. For a total of 28 reps, those will take off on top of your screen. And Catherine Davis' daughter is out front way early. At the bottom of the screen is Lauren Fisher, who is even with Catherine Davis' daughter. Davis' daughter looking to reclaim her lead, but
this is a long plow sprint. So if Lauren Fisher's going out a little too hard, it'll cost her on the way back. Catherine Davis' daughter looks like she's at a relaxed pace, pushing herself. She's used to sled pulls. She does a lot of them. This is a little different, but still on the legs, she's looking really smooth in the transition on that turnaround.
Catherine Davis-Otter was the first to make the turn and head back down. Samantha Briggs is behind her in second, along with Lauren Fisher. Briggs is just slightly ahead of Lauren Fisher, and Sarah Sigmund's daughter currently sits in fourth place. But Anna Tunnicliffe is putting the pressure on Sigmund's daughter, and Carl Webb is there in that battle as well.
More importantly, though, for Davis' daughter, if she wants to be crowned the champ 2 years in a row, she has to stay ahead of Tia Toomey.
Whoever wins between Davis' daughter and Toomey in this race will be your overall leader. It's pretty simple, as Catherine Davis' daughter is going to take back the overall lead, and she's going to crush Emily Abbott's time. Briggs is putting on a last-ditch effort to beat Davis' daughter, but Catherine Davis' daughter is your overall leader. 138.48 seconds, another 50 points as she wins two of the three events here in the soccer stadium. Sarah Sigmund's daughter will come across in third place overall. Lauren Fisher is in. Anna Tunnicliffe has finished. Brooke Wells and Carl Webb have all come across the finish line. So Tia Toomey had the lead, lost the lead, had the lead, and now has lost the lead again.
It is all over the board in this women's race. There has been 7 lead changes before even coming into today. 5 different women in first. It's just been ridiculous. On the women's side of competition, it is unreal. There was some mishap there at the end. Some of the athletes didn't know how far they had to pull the sled or the plow across the line. That's going to shake some things up where they thought they were finished, especially for Brooke Wells, who was coming into today in 5th place. If she was one of those ladies with the error, that's going to be costly points for her. So we'll see how this thing shakes out for the leaderboard. What a great competition this year on the ladies' side.
Yeah, Brooke Wells is trying to work her way into the top three. She came into this event in 5th place overall. The bottom line is that Tia Toomey unofficially will have a 21-point lead. I'm sorry, Catherine David's daughter will have a 21-point lead on Tia Toomey heading into the final event as she picked up 22 points on her here in the plow. And that'll do it for the women in the soccer stadium. And they get to find out what's next for them. But Catherine David's daughter wins 2 of the 3 events here and picks up some extremely valuable points. And more importantly, regains the overall lead from Tia Toomey.
With not many tests left, David's daughter had to come out strong. She did just that, even with the pressure from Sam Briggs. Nice finish. And she looks so relaxed, even though the pain from that plow and all 3 sprints she just went through, she still looks pretty fresh for it being the last day of competition.
And then getting congratulated from Samantha Briggs, who has said that this is the last time she's going to compete as an individual. So the last time we'll see her at the soccer stadium here at the StubHub Center. The men will be up next as the crowd here at the tennis stadium is staying in their seats here on a very, very warm day. The Catherine Davis daughter setting herself up to become the first woman to repeat as CrossFit Games champion since Annie Thoris daughter went back to back in 2011 and 2012. Now, Catherine David's daughter now is, that's Ian Wittenberg. He's a member of the CrossFit media staff who's helping Catherine and not sure what's going on here. I don't know, maybe she just exerted herself too much, but Catherine David's daughter being helped off the field.
You guys take her, not these guys.
Dave Castro is over there with the medical staff, is now with Catherine.
She's not holding anything, you know. She looked great when she finished. Really interesting.
She's still smiling, so that's a good sign for Catherine David's daughter.
You know, Stacey Tovar had some issues yesterday, not feeling good. It is hot down there. These ladies are pushing themselves a lot. Here's her finish. You know, when you look at her all around, there's no sign.
Right there. I mean, just maybe it's the fact that she just went too hard. You're hoping that there's nothing physically, as far as, you know, structurally wrong with her that's going to hinder her performance here. And she is your overall leader by 11 points.
When you're such a strong athlete like Catherine and you can just flip the switch to be so in the game, in the moment, sometimes your brain just shuts off and your body takes over. And she wanted those points. She came out to get those points. She won the handstand walk, went the entire distance. Same thing with the plow. She is on a mission. This is what she came out to do. And maybe she just pushed herself a bit too hard for what her body needed.
Tia Toomey sits in second. Sarah Sigmund's daughter is in third. 3 quick events for the women are done. The men are going to take the field next. We'll have the handstand walk, suicide sprint, and the plow next.
One step forward.
Boom!
Does CrossFit make women look too bulky?
My honest thoughts?
No. How are we supposed to look?
No other place have they focused on helping women to understand their full capacity.
It's helping redefine our cultural concept of beauty.
I feel beautiful in my body no matter what.
It's changed my life.
in a very positive way.
I've had my right hip replaced, left hip, left knee. After my last surgery, I came here and saw what was going on. I was scared. I lost 20 pounds. My range of motion has changed. Each day it's a challenge, but you have to think positive because I'm not ready to die yet, and I'm trying to keep hope alive.
Do you have to be fit to start CrossFit?
Oh, that's so not true.
I couldn't do one push-up. I couldn't run 400 meters.
I was out of shape. I was almost 300 pounds.
I heard of CrossFit, but I had no clue what it was.
CrossFit showed me a whole new level of what my body can do.
Nobody starts out CrossFit fit. You gotta start from somewhere.
It just takes one day to go inside and try it out. One time, and then you'll know that you can.
Day number 5 for the men starts with a brisk walk on their hands. Thanks for joining us, everybody, for the final day of competition here at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. I'm Sean Woodland with Bill Grundler. Sam Farber is on the field here at the soccer stadium. Overall standings through 10 events, Matt Fraser is all by himself. He has a 160-point lead over Ben Smith. Fraser has the largest margin of victory ever at the CrossFit Games in his sight. Patrick Vellner and Brent Fikowski are locked in a battle for that final spot on the podium. This one, just go 280 feet on your hands.
Yeah, not a big deal. I love the fact that we throw a skill event in here, and the handstand walk has basically become a staple within all the CrossFit events, whether you're talking a regional event or the Games event. And then now here's our race, 280 feet for time. Ready, set, go.
The field is divided into 20-foot sections, and each 20-foot section needs to be completed unbroken. There are two heats of 20 individuals. This is heat number one, so both heats will do this event, and then we will move on to the next event. But one guy you're going to want to watch in lane number four, the big man, Spencer Hendel.
You know, and you wouldn't think gymnastic-type work, but this is what Spencer does very well. It's crazy. In 2015, we did something similar to this. How fast could you do 250 feet? And he did that in 2 minutes and 1 second. Same thing with Garrett Fisher, another tall athlete, but good on his hands. He did that exact same event at the regionals in 2015, 250 feet in a minute, 56 seconds. So these guys are going to have a pretty good battle between them. And then one last shot, if we're going to look at that as our event in the regionals as our measuring stick, he did 250 feet in 149 seconds, and he's going bald on this one. There's the hat. He didn't want to lose it. He didn't want to lose it, Sean.
I thought maybe he would put a chin strap on that thing to keep it on during the event. Heat one of event 11. The handstand walk is underway. I actually talked to Sean Sweeney as James Newberry starts his handstand walk in the hotel lobby the other day. Sweeney said he was looking forward to this event, and then he showed me his hands, and those things are gigantic. He's got 2 feet on his wrists.
Man, I tell you, the evolution of how CrossFitters have become such great. I mean, we've always had guys that are good at these types of things, but look across the board. All these athletes are so good at handstand walks. And look at, oh, geez.
Now, Sean Sweeney just ran into his pylon. Now, that means he did not complete that 20-foot section, so he's got to go back to the beginning of it. So that's a costly mistake for Sean Sweeney. So he'll fall back, but now trying to regain the lead. Ben Stoneberg just kicked down. He was in the lead. Logan Collins is kicked down, as has James Newberry.
And that's going to be part of the strategy. These guys are used to coming down in 10-foot sections. This is the 20-foot section. So if you make a mistake, that can be very costly, that having to walk back that 20 section and start again. You can have a lot of guys pass you by. So you need to be smart. If you think you might come down early so you can take that break and then make the next 20-foot section.
Well, Logan Collins was the man who's farthest down the field. Ben Stoneberg is trying to chase him down. Collins is your leader. He's on the right of your screen. Stoneberg just kicked down. He is in the multicolored shorts in the middle, shaking out his shoulders, taking a look where Logan Collins is and getting back to work. But Logan Collins has 40 feet to go, as does Ben Stoneberg. Collins back up. He's got to get to that next line before he kicks down. Stoneberg, though, is keeping the pressure on Logan Collins. Stoneberg is down, and here goes Collins. And Logan Collins is trying to lock up a win in this heat. 50 points on the line for the winner, and Collins is going to do it. Logan Collins across the finish line first. Ben Stoneberg behind him. Stoneberg is going to get himself in. And now five different athletes vying for third. And it's going to be Lucas Eschlinger, followed by Jacob Anderson, James Newberry across the finish line. And there is Sean Sweeney. Garrett Fisher is about 40 feet away from the finish line, and he has 12 seconds to get there inside the 3 minute time cap. Four seconds before the time cap, and Garrett Fisher will not get to the finish line. The next heat of 20 men will now take the field and perform event 11, the handstand walk, and Garrett Fisher clearly upset at his performance. But Logan Collins will have the time to beat as we head into the second and final heat. Logan Collins, 212.65 seconds.
Yeah, Logan looked absolutely great all the way down. But this is what these guys have to remember. Even though you need to keep that body position, you got to be able to look a little bit ahead of you and know where your vector of direction is going. But Logan Collins is great positioning. And what I liked about what he did is he took a nice big chunk in the beginning, and then he stopped about every 20 feet to make sure he was rested, kept him short, kept those shoulders rested, and allowed him to get up to that front and then sprint through the finish.
Second heat, this guy, Jacob Hebner, pretty good on his hands as well. He's going to try to chase down Logan Collins' top time. All your overall leaders in this final heat.
Yeah, when you talk about a handstand walk, any event that has handstand walks in it, you have to look at Jacob Hebner. He's had some of the best results in the world in these movements. Very confident. Him and Noah Olsen, both these guys just go fist-to-fist, basically, or hand-to-hand, if you want to talk about handstand walks, in these events. So it's going to be fun to watch these guys battle.
Matt Fraser's in the red shorts. He's in the middle of the field, and he's your overall leader. All he has to do is basically just avoid finishing last in these next three events, and he will keep his overall lead. And Ben Smith is in the light blue shorts. He's on the right of your screen. Smith is the man who's trying to chase down Matt Fraser, really the only guy who's got a realistic shot of doing just that. But Ben Smith is going to have to rack up some serious points here over these next three events. Jacob Hebner is your leader. Matt Fraser sitting in third in this heat right now. Scott Panchik catching up to him. There goes Matt Fraser.
Oh my goodness.
Who's catching up with Jacob Hebner as they hit 40 feet to go. Fraser's in the red. Hebner stays on his hands. Noah Olsen's at the top of the screen. He's in this fight. Hebner's down, and here comes Fraser. As Fraser stays on his hands, he might be able to beat Hebner, but Hebner is going to stay up, and Jacob Hebner will take this heat. Now, Matt Fraser is getting even closer to standing atop the podium for the first time here at the CrossFit Games. He will finish second. Panchik is third. Olsen is fourth.
You know, I personally was positioning Matt to be in the middle of the pack on this. I was not expecting him to be up at the front. That was overly impressive with him, which he's been doing time and time again in each one of these events.
Once again, Matt Fraser will widen his lead because he beat Ben Smith across the finish line. Matt Fraser will earn 47 points. Ben Smith finishes seventh. He will get 36, so another 11 points for Matt Fraser's total. Just put that with the rest. More men finishing up. Samuel Kwan is in, along with Jorgen Carl Gubenson. Brent Fikowski coming in. He's trying to get his way onto the podium. Comes in fourth place overall. Into this event, he was just 18 points away from third. But Patrick Velder, the man he's chasing, finished eighth. Fikowski's going to finish 18th. Patrick Vigneault, or Alex Vigneault, I should say, another Canadian athlete, is across the finish line. Now Jacob Hebner will take a quick break, and we will start event 12, the down and back, down and back, down suicide sprint. And if you've ever played basketball or hockey or football or any sport that has lines on the field, you're used to doing these. But Jacob Hebner will win 50 points. Matt Fraser will widen his already monstrous overall lead.
I was so impressed with Matt. I was not expecting him to be up in the front, especially pushing the lead, pushing for the win on this particular event against Hebner. Man, outstanding performance by Matt, and he was very excited about that. But, man, Jacob Hebner, it doesn't matter. You get this kid upside down, and he will go for days and days and days. Very confident, very relaxed, and he knew he wanted this one, and he went out and took it.
The sprint is next. 840 total feet. Down and back format. They'll hit the first pylon, come back. Second pylon, come back. And then it's a final sprint. across the finish line. Matt Frazier, overall leader. Tom Porter has been pretty banged up, hoping that he can score some points here and work his way up the leaderboard.
Yeah, we saw on social media his hands are pretty torn up, his feet are a little torn up, but the thing that I like about Conn is he likes to just get in there. He knows what the test is. He's like, put us to the test, let me see what I can do. He had a great performance as far as like showed a lot of heart yesterday on the road climb event. I want to see if he can kind of hop back up to it here. Joseph Gessner, this guy has been tenacious while he's been here at the games. I mean, he hasn't had necessarily the best finishes overall. I know he's been struggling on some of them, but it's been fun to watch him. He gets in there and just grinds, and it'll be fun to see what he can do here. I'm just going to say he's the red-bearded Terminator. I watch the way he runs. He's extremely regimented in everything that he does, but watch his run.
Lucas Parker did very well in the shuttle sprint event back in 2012, hoping to duplicate that result here in 2016. Conn Porter and Roy Gamboa make the turn. Now down to that far pylon. Gary Helmick in the yellow shorts is out front, but Gamboa will make the turn just ahead of Gary Helmick. James Newberry is towards the front as well. Gamboa makes the final turn. It's Gamboa, Newberry in the middle of the field, and then Gary Helmick at the top of Roy Gamboa.
Wow.
Going to win this thing running away. Now here comes Lucas Parker trying to get himself into second place. He passes Newberry. Gamboa is going to win. Helmick will finish second, followed by Parker, Newberry, then Zach Carchetti.
Wow, that was so impressive with Roy. Now, he's a big, strong athlete. We know he's going to be good on the sprint, but this isn't just a short sprint. It's actually pretty long and painful. That was a great job. He was great on those turns, and that was a good movement for him, and he needed that. Get him back, get some points back for him for this for his weekend.
So in this heat, spots 2 through 6 separated by less than a second.
Just real strong, and look at that stride, so powerful.
Lucas Parker put the pressure on Gary Helmick at the end, but wasn't able to catch up. But Roy Gamboa has the top time as the next 20 athletes are at the start line for the suicide sprint. Gamboa, the time to beat, 43.84 seconds. Meanwhile, Matt Frazier has increased his overall lead over Ben Smith to 171 points. Cole Sager, another former football player, probably looking forward to doing this.
Oh, 100%. You know, he did really well last year in the sprint event here on the field, so he's very comfortable. And again, this is a football-type movement. Down, back, down, back, down, back. Very explosive, very powerful, very fast.
Scott Panchik has worked his way into the top four, now trying to gain ground on third place Patrick Vellner.
And this is a good event for him. He also did well in all of the sprint events that we've had. He wants so bad to get out of that fourth to sixth place that he just constantly is sitting. This will be a great event for him. He can pick up some very valuable points for himself here. And then, hey, guess what? We're in a soccer field. Why not put a soccer player out there and see what he can do running down and back? He came off a great event, finished yesterday, that fourth place in that final event last night. Real happy. I think he's excited about being down here on the grass.
Played goalie at California Berkeley. Second and final heat of event 12, the suicide sprint. Patrick Vellner, who currently sits in third place overall, makes the turn. And Scott Panchik and Marcus Philly out front, along with Noah Olson. Final turn back to the start, and Philly starting to open up a little bit of the lead. Philly, the first man to that final pylon, and now the final sprint to the finish. But look who is there in the red shorts. That's Matt Frazier. Matt Frazier and Ben Smith in a foot race. Are you kidding me? What can this guy do? Matt Frazier is going to win his heat.
You've got to be kidding me. Matt Frazier did not do that last year in the sprint. He did not do that last year in the sprint. Again, this should have been an event that he was in the middle of the pack, not at the front of the pack.
Matt Fraser will finish second in the event and pick up another 47 points. Ben Smith finishes right behind him. So Fraser picks up another three on Ben Smith and will now lead him by 174 points unofficially. Matt Fraser almost won this event. Roy Gamboa will take that.
Let me pick up my jaw off the ground. It doesn't matter what is thrown at him in this particular game. He just crushes nonstop. I was not expecting it to be this fast, but you saw Ben Smith looked over and saw him sweep right by him again. Matt Fraser. Wow. Matt Fraser.
That's Matt Fraser has one finish outside the top 10. He is chasing all kinds of records. The biggest margin of victory at the CrossFit Games. Most top 10 finishes, highest average finish. This guy is redefining dominance here at the CrossFit Games. We still have one event left on the soccer field.
Well, but the thing is, like with Matt right now, he look at the confidence that he has. He's shocking everybody in these events, shocking them. And to know that and be able to come into this final piece of this this skill event, that's going to be huge.
Up next, the implement they're calling the plow, and they got to drag it down and back. If you watch the women's heat, Becca Voigt unfortunately thought it was just one trip.
560 pounds, they got to pick up this implement and drag it down. Different than a normal drag, which most of these athletes have used. They don't get to use their arms to kind of move any sort of, to get any sort of momentum. But I like the idea, and I like the fact that it's an odd movement, and I think if we're talking odd movements and odd implements, Lucas Parker is going to have a very, very good shot at doing well here. He loves just kind of playing with weird objects, and I think that if he hasn't done this accidentally, he's made up something in this in his garage somewhere. Roy Gamboa, very strong, very powerful athlete. We saw what he did on the sprint. I expect him to be very similar here, football player. So he's going to have those good, strong, short, choppy steps. He's going to just drive this thing down the field and back. And then Jacob Anderson. The thing that's so impressive about Jacob is he may not be as big as these other athletes, but he's just so genetically gifted. He comes from such a strong, fit family that I know he's going to do well. And that's kind of what he does. He's either going to do really, really well or he's going to implode. He needs to do really well here.
And Matt Fraser will just look on and wait his turn. His lead is now 174 points over Ben Smith. The plow weighs 235 pounds, and they have to drag it a total of 560 feet.
And as we saw with the girls, there were a lot of women that came out pretty quick and then died on that last half.
And Spencer Hendel in the yellow shorts is out ahead of everybody. And like we said last year in the soccer chipper with the pigs, someone checked the weight on that thing because it looks way too light. Spencer Hendel making quick work of that thing. I'll have to turn it around and drag it back.
And obviously he's extremely strong, but what's helping him is he has those long legs. He's taking those long strides relatively compared to everyone else.
The entire plow needs to get into that white section before they turn it around. And Spencer Hendel, the first man back. And he's going to get through 40 feet before Garrett Fisher even gets onto the field. Now, Garrett Fisher is starting to gain ground on Spencer Hendel. Fisher is in the middle of your screen. Hendel is at the bottom. He has the yellow shorts on.
And look where Spencer's starting to implode a little bit. That's what we talked about. If you go out too fast, you don't have enough gas for the back half of this event. That's exactly what's happening with Garrett Fisher, passing him right up.
Garrett Fisher now has the lead in this heat. Hendel has fallen back into second place. And Garrett Fisher is going to take first place in the first heat of the plow.
Well, Garrett just gave us a lesson of how to handle this. Pace yourself in the beginning so you can come back hard. Man, Spencer Hendel went out like a shot in that first half. And he was just trying to hold on that second half.
Hendel will finish in second place. Sam Dancer is at the top of your screen. He's getting across the finish line. Lucas Eschlinger as well has finished. James Newberry is in, and here comes another Australian. Newberry one, Con Porter the other. Albert, Dominic LaRouche, Ben Stoberg, and Zeke Grove. He's also out of Australia. There's Roy Gamboa, number 21. Lucas Parker on the left of your screen, having to readjust his grip. Ben Stoberg, meanwhile, has crossed the finish line. Gamboa, who won the sprint, is in, but Adrian Moonweiler just beat him across the finish line, and now Zach Carchetti is in. Just two men left on the field, 3 minute time cap, one of whom is Jacob Anderson.
And we talked about this, either he does really, really well, or he kind of drops off down to the bottom. It's all, I don't want to say it's a crapshoot, but you never really know what it's going to do. It's just but he's surprising one way or the other.
Jacob Anderson's in, but that man has your top time, 1 minute 17.90 seconds. It looked like Spencer Hendel was going to run away with this thing.
Literally.
But Garrett Fisher caught up to him on the back half and was able to pass him. Fisher, the only man inside a minute and 20 seconds. Spencer Hendel was 12 behind him, followed by Lucas Esslinger and then Sam Dancer.
Fisher was not in the lead in the beginning, but on that back half, you saw him just creeping up, creeping up, creeping up, and you see him pick up his tempo, pick up that, look, he was actually running at the end, where Spencer was totally walking at the end. Say, he paced it perfectly. That was a great job for Garrett. You saw how frustrated he was with the handstand walk earlier. That was a good one for him. He needed that.
Matt Fraser already trying to get some intel out of Garrett Fisher. Brent Fikowski and Scott Panchik are locked in a battle for third with Patrick Vellner. Fikowski currently sits in fifth place overall. He's 1 point behind Panchik, who is in fourth. And then Patrick Vellner currently has the final spot on the podium. The rookie out of Canada sits in third place.
I really think he's going to do well here. He just does, you know, he's great at just such odd movements. And when he excels, he really excels.
Scott Panchik is once again looking at another top six overall finish here at the CrossFit Games.
A lot of experience. I think you could, you know, put anything in his hands, he's going to do decent. Again, football player, I think he's going to know how to pace himself here with his experience. So, again, he wants to get into that top three. He needs to do well here.
And finally, the man who comes in with a 174-point lead on Ben Smith.
Sean, I want to say that I wouldn't pick him to do very well here, but I wouldn't have done that in the other two events either. So, I like, honestly, he has a very good shot of winning this event, just like he, or placing the top three, because he did the exact same thing.
So Ben Smith has got to start winning some events. We don't know how many remain here on Sunday, but it's safe to say if Ben Smith wants to catch Matt Fraser, he's going to have to sweep whatever's left.
Yeah, I just don't know if he's, he needs to keep himself in the top three. I don't think he's going to be able to catch Matt.
And what a, that's going to be just a blow to Ben Smith to see a guy that you didn't think was supposed to be that fast running, Matt Fraser, passing you on a sprint.
Oh, he watched him. He caught him in the corner of his eye.
£235 on that plow, down and back for a total of 560 feet.
So again, it's all about that pace. How can you get down there where you're comfortable so you can come back and really turn it on? That looks great, but the tempo here across the board looks much slower than what we saw in that first heat with the men.
Josh Bridges is out front early. Matt Fraser is staying even with Patrick Vellner, who is right now in about fourth place. Alex Anderson is in the light blue shorts. He is going to be the first man. He and Josh Bridges in the dark blue. And they will make the turn.
So we see these guys all having that internal grip. We saw earlier, right before they went, Matt was asking Garrett Fisher, hey, how are you holding on to that? Where are you holding on to that? And this is what Garrett told him to do. Now, granted, you only have one of two ways to do it. Grab it the other way or grab it this way. And I think what's happening here is that it allows them to lean forward just a little bit, relaxing their arms instead of trying to use a lot of bicep.
And Lucas Hogberg is doing just that, and he is way out front. The big guy from Sweden has his sights on the heat win. He's not going to get the event win, but Lucas Hogberg comes across the finish line. And now Matt Fraser is going to be in the top four once again.
What the heck is going on?
Domination.
You know what? Okay, I'm gonna throw this out. There's a lot of people that once Rich Froning came out of the CrossFit Games and he went to team, everyone thought there'd always be the asterisk. He's making it so there is no asterisk. There is no asterisk. He's erasing that asterisk.
Ben Smith has just come across the finish line. Smith will finish 23rd in the event. That's good for 17 points. Matt Frazier finishes sixth in the event. That's good for 38. So add more onto Matt Frazier's lead as Noah Olsen is the only man on the field. The last time we saw him with an implement with handles on it, it was last year in Sandbag 2015. And remember, he dumped those sandbags out of his wheelbarrow. That cost him some very precious points.
Yeah, I don't think he's a fan of the wheelbarrow type implements.
Lucas Hogberg will take the heat. Matt Frazier looks like he's finally going to take gold here at the CrossFit Games. But if you ask him, it's not over yet.
It's not over till it's over. You know, that's a great attitude because it keeps him in the game. It keeps him in the game. He's very focused into right here, right now. Not what's coming up, not what he has to do, but what he has to do right at that moment. And that's exactly what he needs to be doing.
Lucas Hogberg will finish second in the event. The only one in his heat is in the top five in this event. Garrett Fisher will take the win after his great performance where he outbattled Spencer Hendel. And here's Lucas Hogberg's finish. He took the lead on that final turn and just widened it from there.
He just looks so strong. He looked very confident. Looked like he's done this before or something like this before. No slowdown at all. Look at that. Super excited about where he finished. But this, I can't say it enough. So impressive. Just keeps on going. And every time you think he should just be in the middle, he's at the top. When he's at the top, he's really at the top. Complete and utter dominance on these events.
Just one event finish through 13 outside of the top 10. We mentioned all the records that this guy is chasing. Largest margin of victory ever at the CrossFit Games. Best average finish in the events. Most top 10s, all of these things, along with a gold medal, the title of fittest man on earth, and $275,000 are within Matt Frazier's reach. We talked about it a couple days ago. There's that phrase, leave no doubt. Jeez, I don't think there's a doubt right now.
No, this is a one-man show with Matt Frazier, an absolute one-man show.
And unofficially, Matt Frazier has extended his gigantic lead over Ben Smith to 195 points. The battle, for all intents and purposes, is for those final two spots on the podium. Ben Smith and Patrick Vellner currently sit there. Brent Fikowski, Jacob Hepner, and Scott Panchik are all trying to get there. Second, and a sixth for Matt Frazier as Sunday is turning in to a victory lap for that man. Head to games.crossfit.com for all the leaderboards, athlete interviews, and updates from the StubHub Center.
Welcome back, everyone. We are coming to you live from the Reebok CrossFit Games. I'm Allison Hagendorf here with Tommy Marquez. Once again, the accurate predictor. I think you need to go to Vegas because everyone you're saying is going to win actually wins. Let's start with the handstand walk with the women.
Yeah, Katrin David's daughter continued her dominance in handstand walk events. I mentioned that she'd won the last two previously in regionals as well. But you know what? She does it here at the games on the grass turf. Just basically blazed out to a lead early on. She was pushed by Kari Pierce to the brink, but manages to eke out those last few feet for the event win. She would back that up in event 13 with a win in the plow as well. Sam Briggs almost caught her at the end, but she was spent. Then in event number 12, Tia Claire Toomey would not go down without a fight. You can see them running down side by side, but it was Tia that would make the final turn and turn on the jets and blow the rest of the field away to win the suicide sprint. At the end of things, Katrin was absolutely spent. Seen her run some hill sprints before in videos, and she will push herself to this level of exhaustion where she needs to get carried off. She did so here. We hope she can just recover.
All right, let's take a look at the overall standings for women right now. What can you tell us from this, Tommy?
Katrin just establishing herself once again, an 11-point lead going into whatever it is we have in the tennis stadium today. Tia Claire close behind, Sarah Sigmund's daughter close behind. It's anybody's ball game.
All right, let's check in with Dave Castro for our next announcement.
Athletes, bring it out. Hustle up. You guys can start filing through there just to expedite this. Come on. Expedite.
I like the purple, babe. Where'd the purple go? I gave you a little bit. Oh,
teams, go to that end. Go over there and stand by down there. Is this all the individuals? Guys, come over here. Okay, look over here. Your next event, individual athletes, is going to be the following. We call it the rope chipper. On the go call, you're gonna step forward. And you're gonna do 200 meters on the ski erg. You're gonna finish the 200 meters. You're gonna come over here, and you're going to do 50 double unders for men, 40 for women. You're gonna come to the row, and you're gonna do 200 meters. You're gonna come forward and do 50 for the men, 40 for the women, double unders again. You're gonna come to the assault bike and go 0.4 miles, and then you're gonna come forward and do what? 50 for the men, 40 for the women, double unders. Come back to the rower, 200 meters. What are you gonna do here? 50 for the men, 40 for the women, double unders. Come over to the ski erg, 200 meters on the ski erg. Come forward and pull this sled all the way to the end, cross the finish line for time. Everybody's been practicing with heavy ropes lately, right? Heavy cabled ropes. That's kind of the thing right now, agreed? How many people have practiced with heavy handled ropes? heavy handled ropes with a heavy cable. Feel it. You guys will get a chance to play around with it in a second. You'll get a chance to play with it. That's your next event. The final has been over a year in the making. It's something I'm really excited about. We get to see if you guys practice at all. Last year, the event you guys did on the tennis floor for the final started with what? Pegboard. Does anyone remember the reps? Three, exactly. Your final event is going to start with three pegboard ascents, and we call this event Redemption, because we're going to get to see who practiced and who trained on something like this over the previous year. It starts with three pegboard ascents, then you're going to come forward and do 21 thrusters with a 135-pound bar for the men and an 85-pound bar for the women. You're gonna head back to the board and do two ascents. Come forward, roll your bar forward, 15 thrusters, head back, one ascent, head down, nine thrusters, cross the finish line, time. They are not back to back. Are you guys excited about your opportunity to show the world how you've all trained on the pegboard and improved over the past year? All right, any questions? Take it back to Boz for the brief. Are you guys excited to see these guys come out? Ten team captains, come forward. Congratulations on advancing. I'm excited for your event too, very excited. How many of you guys and your team practiced on the pegboard over the past year? All right, you guys are gonna do it. And actually, each and every individual on your team is gonna do that exact same event with slight variants. There's actually six different versions. The first version on your team, it's gonna be a female on the go. They're gonna do one ascent, 12 thrusters, 85 pounds, one ascent, nine thrusters, one ascent, six thrusters. That has a 5-minute cap. Then the first male is gonna do two ascents, 12 thrusters, one ascent, nine thrusters, one ascent, six thrusters, also with a 5-minute cap. That's the lowest version. The stepped up version, the middle version, is the following. For the first female on the second version, two ascents, 15 thrusters, one ascent, 12 thrusters, one ascent, nine thrusters with a 6-minute cap. The second male version, two ascents, 15 thrusters, two ascents, 12 thrusters, one ascent, nine thrusters with a 6-minute cap. And then the final version for your top guy is the same that the individuals are doing. So your top guy and your top woman will do three ascents, 21 thrusters, two ascents, 15 thrusters, one ascent, nine thrusters, cross the finish line. Each one of those events has its own time cap. For that final, the time cap is 10 minutes. The first two, 5-5, 6-6, 10-10. Each event is worth 50 points. Each one of those six is 50 points. Any questions? You guys excited about that? Did you get the barbell you wanted? All right, let's head back.
You guys, just for the brief, okay?
Wow, what an announcement by Dave Castro. We're back inside the Rose Garden, everyone, and I'm joined now by five-time Games athlete and one heck of a guy, Dan Bailey. Dan, let's start first with the individuals. We'll go in the order of the announcement. That first event, 200-meter ski erg, 50 double-unders. 200-meter row, 50 double-unders. Assault bike, and then you basically come back the way you came. With this heavy rope, did you test this workout? And what are some of the keys to performance on this particular workout?
I did test this workout approximately 7 to 9 times. Wow. Trying to get the time frame down correctly. A lot of experimenting with the rope. On paper, you look at it, not that bad. But you throw that heavy rope in there, it totally changes things up. It's a very different dynamic. A lot of guys have trained with a heavy rope, but now we have 1-pound handles as well.
Wow.
Let me tell you, it's like nothing else I've ever done. So the keys to this are going to be, how hard can you go on those ergs? Very short distances, you're not on there very long. How hard can you go and keep your double unders unbroken, if that's possible? Maybe one breakup.
And normally with double unders, we see some people start to pile up some no reps, and it really just kind of goes south from there. Was that the case when you tested with these, or how much did the handles and little things on this new rope kind of play into that?
Once you get on the rope, your focus is totally more dialed in than a normal double under. You're jumping a little bit higher, you're swinging harder, you're just trying to stay focused on what you're doing. And yeah, as soon as you get one trip up, for me, when I would get a trip up, I would take a nice big breath, know that I was confident to knock out the next set and not have to trip up again.
So a nice workout there, but the finale, it's going to be a little bit revamped from last year. Last year, the talk of the programming was the pegboard, and you know what? We get it again for the individuals. But this time we kind of up the ante a little bit more on the pegboard here.
For sure. We're doubling the amount of reps, 6 reps. And you say 6 reps, the pegboard is really like 12 reps in one. All the little motions coming in and out of the pegboard and then dropping back down. It's a lot more than it looks like on paper again. Pairing it with the most awful movement in CrossFit, at least for me, the thruster. And we're skipping the 95 pounds for the men, going right to 135. It's going to be a blast.
And so last year, the fatigue level at this point was through the roof. Talk about what maybe the athletes are feeling this year given the program. I know you've tested a lot of it, so maybe what are some of the things we might see in terms of fatigue affecting these pegboard descents?
I've had a couple conversations with some athletes, and some of them said I'm not as fatigued as I have been in past years. Other people are saying different things, that they are fatigued. I think that if you're going to run into a big problem on this pegboard, it's because you haven't prepared the entire year long. It was thrown out of the games last year. It's a very classic movement. It goes very back to early CrossFit training. Pegboard has been in there. So if you haven't been training it and you're not ready for it, it's going to stump you. If you've been training for it, this is going to be a really nasty workout because you're going to be able to go really hard.
And speaking of pegboards now, we're going to look at the team event, because it's not just the individuals that get to tackle this. The teams get to, too, a vastly different variety of workouts for the team members. Starting with the early guys, they're going to go 12 thrusters first for the very first female, one pegboard ascent. And it's going to go 12-9-6 for those thrusters. And that first female is only going to do one pegboard ascent per round, up to only 10 feet. So not only is the rep scheme go down, but it's shortened. And then it only gets tougher from there in terms of upping the ante for pegboard ascents and upping the numbers for thrusters. Is the strategy as straightforward as it seems? You just put your best people last?
I think so. I mean, you're going to know your team, you know who to play, you know who to put in the right positions. That's going to be a big part of this. So hopefully you've trained this movement, hopefully everybody's familiar with what they can and cannot do, or who's the most capable, and you can align your players as appropriately.
And of course, these will all be separate events. It'll be relay style, similar to the solos last year. Dan, thank you so much for joining me at the desk. We're going to take a brief break. Don't go anywhere, guys. We'll be back in just a moment.
Right hip replaced, right knee, I had a laminectomy, left shoulder replacement twice, left hip, left knee. I'm a diabetic, I have a cardiac problem, and I have arthritis. I was in rehab in July, and it gave me a lot of thought of myself and what was going around in my age bracket. I had some real serious thinking and re-evaluating my whole life. After my last surgery, I came here and saw what was going on. I was scared. but I took the challenge. I lost 20 pounds. My range in motion has changed. I have not been able to tie my shoes since 2006. I can tie my shoes now. Each day it's a challenge, but you have to think positive because I'm not ready to die yet.
Back, everyone. I mean, when you're at a show that is this magnitude, you don't really think about it, right? So think about all the Rogue equipment that is here. I mean, it's astounding. I think we actually have some of the numbers to show you all the Rogue equipment that is here at this massive competition.
I mean, just look at those numbers. They are staggering. 1.4 million pounds of gear. And when they say 30 trucks, they're not talking about 30 Toyota Tacomas like the one Dan Bailey rolled up to the games earlier. They're talking about 18 wheelers, 30 of them. I can't even imagine what that would look like side by side. Zeus alone weighs 85,000 pounds, 1,200 barbells. I mean,
150,000 pounds of bumper plates.
I mean, into the soccer stadium, you see Zeus, and obviously it's immense, but just being down on the field, you get a little bit better feel. It's 240 feet long, 18 feet wide. It's two stories tall. I remember Katie telling me last year that you could straight up take one of the 18-wheelers that they packed it in and drive it right across the top of that rig, and it would be just fine as if the athletes were working out right below it. I mean, it's just absolutely insane the amount of work that goes into it. We totally appreciate what Rogue has been doing for us to provide all of this equipment and obviously making sure that the athletes have the absolute best equipment out there for them to come out and perform and showcase their talents.
And of course, I want to thank all the volunteers always, because we not only need, of course, all the Rogue equipment, but all the volunteers that make this massive competition possible.
Yeah, some of the hardest workers here are the volunteers that are moving and absolutely setting up this equipment left and right. When you see an event end, a lot of people just, you know, take a break from their seat, go grab a beer, maybe one of those steaks we had yesterday. But these volunteers are busting their hump to move weight in and out, set up for every event, and it's phenomenal. Very much a big thank you to them.
Yes, very, very grateful. We have the adaptive workout coming up next in the tennis stadium. See you in a bit.
Somerset, Mass. Brendan Ferreira. Lane number three. Out of the U.S. Air Force in Wisconsin, Logan Farr. Lane number four. CrossFit San Francisco zone, Max Conserva. And lane five. U.S. Army out of Hawaii, Blake Johnson. We got a 6-minute AMRAP for these fellas. Get a clock going. I'm going to keep track of the time. It's going to be 5 power cleans. 3 of our athletes working with 125, 2 with 85 pounds, 5 D-ball ground over the shoulder, and 5 burpees. We're going to go in 1 minute. 30 seconds, guys. 30 seconds. Seconds. All right, guys. Here we go. A 6-minute AMRAP. 3, 2, 1, go. All right. Gonna go 6 minutes all the way through, as many rounds as possible. 5 power cleans. If you're looking down at the floor, right in the center, right there, Logan Farr working with that 80-pound D-ball. We've seen those all week here at the CrossFit Games. Logan moving forward. Everybody loves burpees. Somebody say yay, burpees. All of our reps here, 5 on the power cleans, 5 D-ball ground overhead, and 5 burpees. Now we're going to go as many reps as possible. Coming up on the 1-minute mark, Logan out in front. That 125 barbell. Blake moved his barbell forward. Hey, man, that's okay. Just keep moving. A lot of different adaptations here, but everybody doing the same movement. All right, you see Brendan down there in lane number 2. He has his own mechanism there for those power cleans. Seems to be working awful fast with him. Logan Farr in lane number 3 out in front in the blue shirt. As we come up on the 2-minute mark. Just 90 seconds in. Your leader, Logan Farr, starting round number 3. Our fellas working hard on that D-ball. Paying homage to the rest of our athletes here this week. Seeing D-balls earlier in the competition. Lake working on that next set of burpees. Lake, a U.S. Army vet out of Hawaii. All day, I could do this all day, boy. I'm finna turn this town. Any day, yeah, in the streets, boy. It's been a month. About 2 minutes, 20 seconds in. You know, I still go wild, like a light-skinned slave, boy. I've had the pleasure of seeing these athletes at multiple competitions throughout the last few years. All of them go hard, up for any challenge. Max heading back for another round. Your leader right in the center of the competition floor, wearing that blue shirt as we come up on 3 minutes in, halfway. A 6-minute AMRAP. Sounds like a short time, but down here on the tennis floor, it is steamy. Give it up for your adaptive segment, pushing through this 6-minute AMRAP. Grinding away. No flex zone. No flex zone. They know better. Brandon. They know. Making quick work of that D ball. Logan. No marks on the bar. My man's been working that power clean nice and steady. One handed. 125 on the bar.
It's the same difference. H2O, same thing.
If you're looking furthest from the rig, that'll be our lane number 1, and closest to that rogue rig is lane number 5. 4 minutes in, gentlemen, that's your 2-minute warning. My count is correct, Logan Farr. U.S. Air Force vet, down in lane number three, in the center of the competition floor, your leader. I believe that's round number five starting for him. Five, and five. If you're just joining us, our adaptive segment, 90 seconds remaining out of a six-minute AMRAP. Five power cleans, five D-ball over the shoulder, and five burpees. Everybody loves burpees.
No flex zone. No flex zone. They know better. They know better.
Catch and play. Catch and play. A lot of these athletes know rookies for competition. Been seeing them all over the place. 1 minute remaining. Logan out in front. Five burpees before he'll head back. Lake working on that D-ball, that camo hat. I don't know how he keeps that hat on his head.
I woke up feeling like I was on the moon.
A man's working hard. 40 seconds left, fellas. Let's take it all the way.
In my sleep, trying to catch a beat. Some bitch in my face, trying to...
Max with another rep. Don't smile at me. Grab the ball, my friend. Keep moving. 20 seconds. He's like, man, this is a long 6 minutes. 15 seconds remaining. We're going to count you down, fellas. Keep moving. 10 seconds. 5, 3, 2, 1. Time. Give it up for our adaptive segment here. A nice little workout. I'm here with Logan Farr. Would you get into the sixth round?
I think so. I have no idea.
I think it was six. On my count, it was six. I'll say it's six. How'd it feel?
Suck.
A six-minute AMRAP. The numbers are small. Five, five, and five. It's difficult, right? You're like, oh, small numbers. I can get right through it. What was your strategy?
Faster on the burpees and the D-balls, and I hate burpees. They're slow.
No, everybody loves burpees. I heard you guys talking a lot of mess back there. You guys like competing with each other. How many times have you competed with each other?
This is mine and Blake's first time. I think mine and Max is second. I think mine and Logan's third. It's always a back and forth.
Awesome. Give it up one more time. We're going to send it back to the Rose Garden, guys. Thank you guys very much.
That is just simply incredible. I mean, I'm just sitting here awestruck with so much admiration. It's really fantastic.
Yeah, it's great to get caught up in, you know, the exploits of the top athletes, you know, but to see these adaptive athletes be able to perform at a level and take something that most people on the outside looking in might consider a tragedy and turn that into a positive and find ways to basically just kind of forge through and turn that into a positive situation for themselves and just keep training hard too, you know. They're members of the community throwing down at the boxes too and getting after it just like the rest of us.
And in addition to that, I just hope those athletes know how much you are inspiring all of us, really. Thank you so much. It's awesome. All right, let's talk more about event 414 for the women, Breathe and Repeat. Who's your pick for this one?
Well, you heard what Dan Bailey said earlier. He said as long as you stay focused on the double unders and you can manage that, then it really comes down to the ski erg, the assault bike and the row, how hard you can push the pace on those things. And when it comes to those particular movements, I'm going to go with Sam Briggs. They call her the engine from England for a reason.
She won
the marathon row. She also won the short sprint row back at the games in 2013. It doesn't matter. As long as it involves your lungs, she is going to be good at it. And I think this is an opportunity for her, despite some less than ideal finishes, to make a charge back up to the leaderboard with the final couple of events.
Right. And what about the men?
On the men's side, well, surprise, surprise, Matt Frazier. At this point of the game, with how well he's done in just about everything, Unless you're picking Matt Fraser to do well in every event, you probably have to be crazy at this point. After those last three events and doing so well, finishing second in the sprint, an event that he almost finished last year.
That was insane.
I already know he can do the double unders. And last year we saw in that final event, he'll say it himself, he went dummy on that assault bike and just absolutely destroyed that apparatus. It may have cost him in the end, but he is more than familiar with those particular movements. So I expect him to come out and just kind of put the finishing touches on what's been a phenomenal weekend for him.
So many exciting moments ahead. Now we caught up, we did Rogue by the Numbers earlier, and we also had the opportunity to check in with Katie Matter-Henniger, who's one of the co-owners of Rogue, to learn more about the magnitude of this operation.
Well, Bill and I have been a part of CrossFit, the CrossFit Games, since 2008. That's when I competed. And we've been the official equipment supplier since 2010. It's been a great relationship. We really enjoy being a part of this and being a part of the community and putting on a great event. We've released a few of the new products that we have. We have some still to come, but the one that they just used in the team event was the Fat Bar. It's 13 feet long, it weighs 84 pounds, and it's 2 inches in diameter, so a little bit of a twist on the axle bar for the teams. But we have some really cool things coming out, and I can't wait for them to be released. We go through multiple prototypes usually for each equipment, and sometimes it doesn't work out. Bill and Dave start talking about it after the games, and then in January it picks up and they're going back and forth on ideas. But we usually come up with a pretty good thing here that the athletes can use. So we brought about 30 trucks out here. It's 1.4 million pounds. And Zeus alone is 85,000 pounds. So we have 1,200 barbells here, about 300,000 pounds of bumpers. So it's a lot of gear. We have about 40 people, just employees, that we brought from Rogue and kind of around the country that contract with us that we've met along the way, and they've been here 3 or 4 years. But we could not do this without the help of the volunteers. I think it's so great that they come out here and they work hard, and they have to lift a lot of weight, and they got to move a lot of equipment, but we definitely couldn't do our job without them.
So obviously the word has gotten out that I am just as passionate about food as I am CrossFit and rock and roll. And Rory better not show up for this. Rory, we love you, but he didn't leave so much of the pork belly for us yesterday.
Yeah, look at all this food. We're going to have – I actually think we should set up a perimeter because I have a feeling Rory's going to come charging
hands
in right
Rory.
Now to steal.
All right, let me tell you what we have here because there's so much amazing food here. It's such a big part of the CrossFit Games, actually. So we have paleo tacos. So they're basically lettuce wraps, and you have your choice between chicken and tri-tip. But why choose? I say yes to both. Then we also have these acai bowls. And actually, we were fighting over the pronunciation, you and I and Kiki and Rory, whether it's acai or acai.
I think the jury's still out.
I don't know. Maybe hit us up and let us know what you guys think. But you can get these acai bowls / acai bowls with berries and granola and bananas and your choice of either almond butter or peanut butter, which is delicious. There's like cocoa nibs in there, I think.
Oh, man, that looks awesome.
And then, of course, this poke tuna. This is my favorite
from
the kitchen.
I love fresh fish. It's one of my favorites. I'm excited to eat that.
But I'm actually going to start eating it right now before Rory gets here.
But you know what? I'm going to quote one of our videographers at CrossFit headquarters.
Amazing.
We're adults. We can eat dessert first, so I'm going to go for the bowl first here.
Fair enough. All right, so I'm going to be very busy right now eating. In the meantime, we're going to show you an updated schedule we have for the rest of the day. All right, we have the team event next. Then, of course, women's event 14, which we just talked about with the heavy ropes. I'm so excited to see how the women do with that.
Yeah, I love double unders. Even then, for some of these athletes with this heavy rope, you're going to have to keep your shoulders basically tense the entire time. You won't be able to relax because of the weight of the rope going. You don't want it to slip out of your hands. And then you have these heavy handles as well, so you're going to have to spend more time trying to turn those handles around. And I have a feeling it's just going to fry their shoulders.
It's going to be very frustrating. So they've never used this rope, so they're not sure how to sort of pace and strategize to get through all these double unders.
This is one of the unknown elements that I absolutely love about CrossFit. They went out of their way, Rogue Fitness again, to machine these jump ropes. Based on what I heard about how they machine this this steel to make these ropes, these are probably like $100, $150 jump ropes that they had put out all the stops to make sure we had some new equipment for these athletes. It's phenomenal.
Awesome. Now, we're definitely going to take a picture of us eating this food. I posted a big picture of me in the 40-ounce prime rib yesterday. But, of course, guys, we want to see the pictures from you. So make sure using the hashtags CrossFit and CrossFit Games, CFG10 to honor the 10th year anniversary, and, of course, the CFG hunt, that scavenger hunt that's going on in the Vendor Village. Let's check in. Oh, here are some more pictures right now. Perfect.
Great picture.
Wow, what a great capture.
I mean, that really just captured the kind of effort and the pain that the athletes go through, especially in a workout like Merv. Oh, it's an awesome photo with Anna Tunnicliffe and 2010 champ Kristen Clever. Get to see some of these top athletes walking around. And we talked about it earlier,
the
magnitude of Zeus from the ground floor. You get to see it in all of its beauty. It's a great one. You get both of the Anderson brothers at once. Two CrossFit Games athletes, two brothers, one shot.
That is an amazing photo, guys. Keep those photos coming. What else do we have coming up? We got some more. Oh, there it is. All right. Guilty as charged. Yeah. I'm the meat maven. Okay. Back to the paleo tacos. This is delicious.
I think I'm going to give myself a brain freeze because I'm just devouring this.
And one last check-in with weather. Sorry, I'm being so rude. It's actually feeling quite gorgeous right now. 82. We can handle that. We can handle that.
And you see the wind picked up a little bit from earlier. Earlier today, it was about 7 miles an hour, picked up to 9. Humidity has stayed about constant, so the athletes have already been out on the soccer stadium to feel these temperatures, so nothing new, nothing crazy for them.
Guys, so much more ahead. The team event is next. We're going to get busy here with the tuna, and we'll see you in a bit.